other training sessions, we have understood that a building's performance or the experience of being in a building is affected by more than just the temperature prevailing outside or the amount of sunlight coming in. We had also understood the pivotal nature of the humidity that is experienced by the building's occupants. The deconstruction of that phenomenon, humidity at the same time dealing with temperature, these two sort of simultaneous forces that affect a building, the process of deconstructing and learning that is called psychrometry, and that's what we're going to cover in this training session. Right, so we'll first understand psychrometry and we'll be able to do some assessments and utilize it for some real world benefits in building design. In addition to that, we will then cover teaching aids that you can use to sensitize, to build motivation, to build skill, and also experiential learning amongst your students if you happen to be a teacher of psychrometry. Right. We will cover this in a later part of the training, but in addition to psychrometry, the other analysis tool that is very powerful and effective in designing thermally comfortable, energy efficient buildings is the SunPath. Psychrometry and SunPath knowledge and the use of solar geometry completes the fundamental knowledge that we need to design passive buildings, which means buildings that need as little artificial energy as possible, post which we will understand how, once the passive opportunities have all been harnessed, what do you still need to do in terms of artificial cooling. So psychrometry is one half of the fundamental knowledge that is required to design thoughtful buildings. Right. Psychrometry, as we indicated, is a science of understanding the air mixture, which essentially means humidity as well as the other dry components of the air, and also the temperature involved in it. And we will use the device of the psychrometric chart to understand how humidity and air temperature interact and are in many instances conflated and lead to a certain kind of thermal comfort experience and how it can be manipulated to bring in thermal comfort. Right. This is a classical representation of the psychrometric chart. We've included this here just to give you a sense of how complex and how daunting it can look when it is first observed, you know, in the hands of an engineer, etc. It can be a very, very formidable looking entity and usually creates distance and aversion to get involved. What we're going to do in today's training is look at a simplified version, which takes away some of these intermediate lines and allows your mind to actually comprehend some of this complex information that is presented here. So let's do that. This is a cleaner version of that chart. It has all the information, but is more inviting and more welcoming for people who might not be so comfortable with numerical analysis, etc. So let's now demystify this chart even further. We will go step by step and look at all the layered information that is presented here. If we go back just a second, we can actually see that this chart is almost like an analogy can be drawn to an AutoCAD drawing. Like an AutoCAD drawing that has multiple layers of, say, plumbing, of electrical, of materials, etc. You will see that this chart also has multiple layers of information, and we will try to now dissect it layer by layer to see how these charts were first composed. All right, so let's start with the first layer. The first layer of information presented here on the x-axis is called dry bulb temperature. It's nothing but the temperature that can be measured by sticking a thermometer in the air, right? And as you can see, it increases from left to right. It goes from 0 to 50 degrees because those are the conditions that are likely to be encountered in most typical urban buildings, right? So the next layer is also a temperature layer, but it is distinctly different from what's called dry bulb temperature. This is what's called wet bulb temperature. This has been a bugbear for a lot of people, this term wet bulb temperature, and we've heard, you know, many conflicting definitions of it, in some cases even humorous definitions of it. Very simply put, wet bulb temperature is the temperature you could simulate right now upon yourself even or on a thermometer that you are using by promoting evaporation from the surface that is sensing the temperature. So say for example you have a thermometer and you apply a wet cloth on the bulb. That makes the bulb wet. Now if that wetness can be allowed to evaporate through the presence of just some air around, and if the air is not saturated, spontaneously the air, the water molecules will start changing phase, and as they change phase they will pick up the latent heat of evaporation, which we saw in another training session is a very, very significant source of extraction of heat. Once the latent heat of evaporation has been taken by the water molecule, it becomes a vapor molecule and it dissipates and diffuses into the air, into the surrounding air. However, what has happened is that in the process of extracting the heat, the mercury, which is the measuring entity inside the thermometer, has lost its heat. As it loses heat, it cools itself and it contracts. And what happens is in the scale of the thermometer, the temperature levels go down. We will see this later in a worked example where we will show the dropping down of this temperature scale in a wet bulb thermometer. Another way of experiencing what this wet bulb temperature would be, in addition to doing that experiment with the thermometer, would be to soak yourself or a cloth that you are wearing in water and stand under a fan. The temperature you would feel would be the same as the wet bulb temperature because the evaporation would happen from your skin. So in a way, there could be an experiential learning opportunity here that could be used by teachers to experience what wet bulb temperature is for a certain dry bulb temperature. One nuance about wet bulb temperature, which we will now explore, is that it is an indicator of the amount of humidity in the air. For example, if the temperature right now is say 30 degrees, the dry bulb temperature, and if the humidity is very high, say if it's about 90% humidity, which is often the case in say coastal regions right before monsoons, one can imagine that the amount of evaporation that will happen from that wet cloth would be relatively meager, which would mean that the amount of heat extractable through evaporation is relatively low, which means the wet bulb temperature will not be very different from the dry bulb temperature because not much evaporation is possible. Conversely, if this was a very dry place, the amount of wetness will very rapidly evaporate and pull down the temperature of the measuring device, whether it's a person or if it's a thermometer, and will create a large difference between the wet bulb and dry bulb temperatures. Let's see how this is manifest in this psychrometric chart. Right. So let's look at the wet bulb and dry bulb temperatures for this point in the psychrometric chart. There is a small layer of information which we will get to in a little bit, but that has basically got to do with the humidity levels here and the relative humidity. So these lines are the relative humidity lines, and these, the y-axis here, is the absolute or the specific humidity line. Now, let's start with a condition where the temperature of the air is 20 degrees. The humidity is not 100% humidity, it's slightly lesser. This is the 100% humidity line. We can imagine that there is some opportunity for evaporation, right? Now, how do we get to know what is the wet bulb temperature for this specific dry bulb temperature? The way one does this is you draw a line diagonal in parallel to these red colored lines. They're called enthalpy lines. We'll get to this in a bit. Once the diagonal line has been drawn through that point, the point at which it intersects this wet bulb axis is the wet bulb temperature for this dry bulb temperature. What this indicates in this instance is that for a 20 degree dry bulb temperature and a humidity, we can't see this here because of this tag, but this is 80% humidity. When the humidity conditions are 80% RH, we will be able to get a wet bulb temperature that is 3 degrees lower than 20, which means a temperature difference of 3 degrees, which is also called the wet bulb depression. Now let's look at what would happen if we were at 100% saturation, which means no possibility of evaporation, right? As you can see, this is that second point. Earlier the point was here. Now we are in a more humid condition. This is 100% humidity. Even the absolute humidity is higher. And here we can imagine that there is no, even if you do draw a diagonal line, you are already at the saturation line, which means the difference between dry bulb and wet bulb temperature is zero, right? 20 degree dry bulb, 20 degree wet bulb. Thereby emphasizing the point that the drier the air, which means in this case, the greater the difference between dry bulb and wet bulb. The wetter the air, the lesser the difference. And this is true for any part of the psychrometric chart. Now let's get to the humidity bit of things, right? We said that psychrometrics is about temperature and humidity, and it's about the air and vapor mixture. The first piece of humidity information, which now forms the third layer of information, is what's called the specific humidity, which is on the y-axis, and the units are grams of moisture per kilogram of air. These are very small levels. If you can see, this is 5 grams of moisture per kilogram of air. But in the study of buildings or in the kind of thermal comfort or discomfort that humidity can create, small increments in these values can lead to a lot of thermal discomfort. So these values might seem small, but they are very, very important on a relative scale. All right, so thus we can see that it increases from 0 to 30 here. Now, combining temperature and humidity, one can see that as you go to the right, you're getting hotter, and as you go to the top, you're getting wetter. So immediately one can get a sense of, if I was, say, in a Chennai sort of situation, most of my weather conditions would be represented by this region, hot and wet. Whereas, say, if I was in a Simla or another cold place, I would be most likely in this part of the region. And if I was in a place that didn't have much humidity, I would be in the dry and cold part of the chart, right? So this is sort of the story. It goes hotter and wetter as you go up. Now, the second humidity parameter, or the fourth layer overall, is what's called the relative humidity. It is defined as the amount of moisture in air compared to the maximum moisture that it can hold. This has been a very confounding thing for a lot of practitioners, the difference between specific humidity and relative humidity. A very simple way to think about this is that specific humidity is almost like just saying the number of marks I got in an exam. So one can say that I got 5 marks in the exam. While that does convey some information, it doesn't really help us to know whether that's good or bad. Is that high or is that low? You would need to know what is the maximum marks I can get. So say, for example, the maximum marks were 10. 5 marks would mean 50% is my success. Whereas if the maximum marks were, say, 50, that would mean only 10%. So specific humidity provides only one part of the truth, or an indicator of the humidity conditions. One would need to know what is the maximum possible humidity to know whether we are in a place that is humid and sticky, or are we in a relatively dry place, right? So this is that layer of information. It goes from 0 here to 10%, 20%, 30%, 40%, 60%, 80%, so on and so forth. Now, what is interesting is that we can be at the same level of absolute humidity, but as we go to the left, you will see that this line, one horizontal line, intersects with lines of higher and higher relative humidity. How is that possible, right? Think about this. My humidity level absolutely is not changing, but as I move to the left, which is actually as I move to a colder region, the relative humidity is increasing. What this indicates is that as I move to the left, the holding capacity of the air in terms of moisture holding capacity is reducing. Intuitively, does this make sense? Let's think about this. We all know that as air becomes cooler, it becomes more dense. A denser fluid will have less capacity to hold external things such as moisture. As we're going to the left, the air is getting colder and it's getting denser. What that means is that even though I have the same amount of moisture per kg of air, for example, 15 grams, that 15 grams in this instance, when the air was warm, represented 20% marks in a way. But as I go to the left and I come here at 35 degrees, once I'm 15 degrees cooler, what that means is that my holding capacity has reduced. So the same number of marks in a way lead to greater percentage, in this case 40%. So this is how one can think through this confounding idea of constant specific humidity but changing relative humidity. Right. This line is a very important line in a lot of assessments. It's called the saturation line or the dew point line, and we will demystify this in a subsequent couple of slides. The fifth layer is something that is quite alien to architects, at least, and traditional building designers who have been focusing on just the aesthetics and shapes, etc. But it's an entity that is quite well known to engineers and practitioners of air conditioning engineering. This layer signifies what's called the enthalpy of the air. It sounds like a very big word, but essentially what it means is that it's a quantity that conveys the total amount of energy that is contained in the air and humidity mixture. If we go back to our training related to the two sources of, the two ways in which heat is stored in a body or an air, there is sensible heat, which is about the temperature, and there is latent heat, which is the moisture. And as one can imagine, when I go from a cold to hot situation, for the same amount of humidity, say here, my enthalpy will increase, which is happening. And as I go upwards here, for the same temperature, my enthalpy should increase. So essentially, this is tracing that same logical line, which is saying that here I am dry and cold, here I am hot and wet. So as I go up here, my enthalpy levels increase. It is actually a master variable which contains in it the intelligence of two competing ideas, humidity and temperature. Right. The sixth layer is the layer of what's called specific volume of air. Specific volume is nothing but the inverse of density. And we already addressed this idea of density and it being proportional to the temperature, which means the higher the temperature, inversely proportional, the lower the density, right? Things become lighter when they are warmer. Since as I go to the right, my temperature is increasing, my density of air will be reducing, which means my specific volume, which is the inverse of density, will actually rise up. And as you can see here, my specific volume increases from 0.79 meter cube per kg up to 0.9 meter cube per kg, which means 1 kg of air is occupying 0.9 meter cubes here, whereas 1 kg of air was occupying only 0.79 meter cube, which means this was denser, had less holding capacity for moisture, which is why the relative humidity for that same moisture went up. This is the final piece of information that this chart contains. It's called the dew point temperature for any point that you pick over here. Now, remember the wet bulb temperature that we talked about? To calculate the wet bulb temperature, which is the coolest I will feel if evaporation were to happen on a surface, right? To get that, one would go up here, would go along this diagonal, which is increasing humidity, right? As evaporation happens, the humidity of the air increases, but I keep going to the left, which means I get cooler, and that's where I have to stop, because beyond this point, I can't do any more evaporation. The air is saturated. The dew point is also to some degree related, but it is related not to evaporation, it is related to condensation, which means if I have a point here and if I keep the humidity level the same, which means I don't do any more evaporation, but I just cool the air. How to do that, we will talk about later. But say if I just cool the air without adding humidity, without promoting evaporation, but I actually promote condensation of that air, right? what will happen is it'll reach what's called the dew point. This point will keep going to the left. It'll hit the point at which the air can't hold any more moisture, and it will start forming dew, right? Which is where the term dew point arises. That temperature, right, is here. So as you can see, for this point here, which is a dry bulb temperature of 32 degrees, the wet bulb temperature is 25.5, which is the lowest temperature I can get through evaporation. But to be able to condense water vapor out of that air, I have to cool it down to 23 degrees to be able to condense moisture out of it, right? This is the final piece of information that is contained in the psychrometric chart. Now, we can really use this as a tool for doing energy efficient and thoughtful design, which we will embark upon in the next slide. All right, before we start using this as a tool for design, let's see if we have understood and really ingrained these ideas in our consciousness. Let's ask this question: which air condition has more energy? Now, each of those points, if you go back in our training, each of those points in the slides can be called an air condition. It's a condition of air. All the intelligence about that point is included in here, right? The temperature, humidity, the wet bulb temperature that will be applicable, the specific volume, all of this is there in one air condition. Now, what we are asking in the next slide is, which air condition has more energy? So let's start with one point. This is defined by two values, right? The beauty of the psychrometric chart is that once I specify any two values out of those seven layers, I have figured out a certain intersection, right? All I need is two values. Those are the only degrees of freedom, as it's called mathematically. So the moment I select my dry bulb and wet bulb temperatures, I have defined an air condition. So what we're going to do is, in the next slide, we will see what these two points look like. But before that, let's contemplate this from first principles itself. This first air condition is a dry bulb of 35 degrees centigrade and a wet bulb of 25 degrees centigrade. The next air condition has the same dry bulb condition, right? But has a different wet bulb condition. Now, if we remember our previous discussion about the correlation between difference of dry bulb and wet bulb and the relative humidity, we had indicated, or we had spoken about, how when an air condition is dry, you will have a greater difference between the dry bulb and wet bulb temperature. This here is a greater difference between dry bulb and wet bulb, which is 15 degrees. This is a 10 degree difference. Of course, this means that the air is dry, which can be verified in the chart. We will see this later, that this is because the RH, relative humidity, is low, which means evaporation can happen and you can get 15 degrees of cooling in a way through evaporation. This one is relatively more humid air and will have less of a difference between dry bulb and wet bulb. Since this air is also wetter and hotter, right? So the dry bulb temperatures are the same, but this one is a wetter air, more humidity. Of course, the enthalpy will be higher because enthalpy encapsulates temperature and humidity. The wetter and hotter air will have more enthalpy, and that's what we are seeing here. So the answer is almost in here. Which air condition has more energy? Of course, since this is the master energy variable, this one has more energy, and we will be able to see this in the next slide. Right. So these are the two points that we spoke of. Both have 35 degrees as their dry bulb temperature, and here are the two wet bulb temperatures. One is of 20, one is of 25. And you can see 25 versus about 40%, 45% RH, this is the difference. And the enthalpy lines, one can see, this one is at 57 kilojoules of energy per kg of air, and this one is at 75 kilojoules per kg of air, and this air has more energy. Another way of saying this is that to cool this air, you will have to expend more energy to bring it into the comfort zone. This one is already close to the comfort zone and will need less energy to be able to cool it. Cut. Let's do another exercise to further dwell upon the concepts of psychrometry. Let's first start with plotting these two air conditions. And as you can see, in this case, the two parameters provided are not two temperatures as they were in the previous case. This one here is a dry bulb of 25 degrees centigrade and a humidity ratio, HR, of 20 grams of moisture per kg of air. And the second air condition is dry bulb of 30 degrees and the same humidity ratio. Our question is, the first one, what is the RH, the relative humidity for both? This is a bit of a, in a sense, a trick question. You might think, oh, both of these have the same humidity ratio, so they should have the same RH. But if we hark back to the considerations that lead to having, lead to the situation where you can have the same humidity ratio, but different relative humidity, this is the phenomenon at play here. Now, before we even go and pictorially depict this on the chart and answer these questions, let's go back to first principles. Between these two air conditions, I'm sure you will all agree that this air, the second air condition, is a warmer air, which means it is less dense than this air, which therefore means that this air can perhaps hold more moisture than this air, which means that even though the humidity ratio of both is the same, this air being warmer, having more capacity to hold air, will have a lower RH, which means it's drier than this air, which is cooler but denser and hence has lesser holding capacity. So my bet is that this RH is going to be lower than this RH, and we will verify this in the next slide. The second question is, what is the specific volume of both air? In a way, this has also been answered in the consideration for the previous question. Since specific volume, which is the inverse of density, is related to the temperature of the air, we can tell that the warmer air will occupy more volume per unit mass, which means that this air should have a higher specific volume than this one. The exact value we will be able to tell in the next slide. These two questions will be addressed in the subsequent slides when we look at them pictorially. The final one, though, is a very interesting proposition. If we were to select the air that is more humid, immediately there's a lot of conflicting ideas that emerge in our mind. Are we speaking of humidity ratio? Are we speaking of relative humidity? And as we've seen, that in one of those parameters is constant, humidity ratio is constant, but the RH is different. How do we then decide whether this air or this air is more humid? We will understand this in a short period of time. All right, so these are the two air conditions. Both have the same humidity ratio of 20 grams per kg. This one is the warmer air at 30 degrees. This one is a cooler air at 25 degrees. Now let's go back and verify the answers to the question. What is the RH for both? We had said that this air will have, the second air condition at 30 degrees will have a lower RH and this one will have a higher RH. Let's see if that's the case. As we can see, the warmer air has a RH slightly less than 80%, whereas the cooler air has the same amount of humidity ratio but has 100% RH, which means it's saturated, right? So this one will be around 78% or 75%, this one will be 100. Now let's go back to the second question. What is the specific volume of both air? Again, we had said that this one will have a higher specific volume, this one will have a lower specific volume. Let's see if that is true. As we can see here, the specific volume lines, by the way, are these diagonal lines. This one, which is the cooler air, has lower specific volume than this one. As you can see, the specific volume increases because the density is reducing. This one is at 0.87 meter cube per kg. This one is somewhere between 0.88 and 0.89. So this might be, we can say this is about 0.89 meter cube per kg. So this one has higher specific volume than this one. Let's go back to the previous slide. What is the maximum moisture that both air can hold? Now, this is a tricky one. What is the maximum moisture that this air and this air can hold? How do we answer this question? Let's go to the next slide. All right. To answer that question, let's look at what are the pathways available for these two points of air conditions under the influence of increasing humidity, right? We're talking about adding more moisture to see how much more it can hold. Let's start with this air. Imagine I have a box of 1 kg of air, which is represented by this dot. It's at 25 degrees, and I am somehow able to just keep adding moisture into that box of air through a hose, say for example, but keep the temperature the same. Wouldn't you agree with me that I cannot actually add any more moisture even if I try, because this air is already saturated, which means I have no place to go. I can try to add humidity, but it will not get absorbed in the air. Instead, it will just condense out, or it will just trickle down as water, right? So this air can only hold 20 grams of moisture per kg of air. It's already there. However, the situation is different for this second air condition. As you can see, there is still some room for this air condition to absorb moisture, which is indicated here on the y-axis, before it gets saturated. So the maximum moisture this air can hold can be calculated by drawing a line going straight up to the saturation line and reading the moisture level there, and we'll be able to see that this air can actually hold about 27 grams of moisture per kg of air. It is holding only 20%, only 20 grams, right? So in a way, we can actually verify that the RH, which is the amount that it's holding versus the amount that it can hold, is in fact 20 divided by 27, which is the point that you get by going up here. And that value, 20 divided by 27, is in fact about 78%, right? So this actually validates that the idea that each of these RH lines is signified by the distance between the lowest point in the chart, which is the x-axis. So, for example, let's look at this point here, 40% humidity. Let's say we have a temperature of 30 and 40% humidity. We can see that it is holding approximately 10 grams of moisture per kg of air. But the maximum that I can hold, right, is if I keep going up, keep going up, I reach 27, which means I am holding 10 over 27. I'm holding 10, I can hold 27. The ratio of those is approximately 40%, which is this value, right? Okay, so let's go back to the final question, which is, which air is more humid? I'll leave that for us to debate till we see the answer. We can form our own thoughts about it, and the answer might be a little surprising. Right, okay, so what is the RH of both? We can see this air, the second air, is less humid because of the increased capacity to hold air because of its density. And this one is 100% saturation, this one is at 75%. What is the specific volume? These are the volumes here. We already looked at this. This is meter cube per kg. What is the maximum moisture both air can hold? We saw that that's 20 for this one. It's already there at 20 grams per kg. This one is at 27. Which air is more humid? If we take specific humidity as the value that determines humidity only, then of course this is a trivial answer. It is the same. However, the RH is different. Let's see if we can reconcile these two conflicting ideas. Same specific humidity and different relative humidity. Pictorially, let's see what this looks like. Right. So here is two masses of air. Both of these can be thought of as 1 kg of air on both sides. They both have 20 grams of moisture. These are 20 balls of moisture. But in that sense, they are equivalent in terms of a mass. So a mass-based explanation for humidity would say both have the same amount of humidity if I were to experience the mass. However, we also know that temperature has an influence on the sensation that the person feels in terms of thermal comfort and stickiness and humidity. This air is actually warmer than this air, right? This should give us a hint that perhaps the volume occupied by this is different compared to the volume occupied by this same 1 kg of air. So imagine we had these magic lenses and we could put them on and we see the world not through mass, but see the world through volumes, which is what we actually do. We see the world through volumes. I can't really tell the mass of this television. I can only perhaps get an indicator of the volume visually. So let's turn on the volume lens. And you will see that the specific volume is higher here, which means the same 1 kg needs more volume. And let's see how that is represented. So the same 1 kg of air, this one has more volume, this one has less volume. Right? If one compares this to, say, a train compartment, right? And this is a train compartment, both carrying the same number of passengers, right? 20 passengers. I'm sure you agree that this one would feel more comfortable for the passengers, right? Even though there's the same number of passengers, this one has more holding capacity, which means that this one would be considered more comfortable or less humid by the occupants. Even though the mass is the same, per unit volume, the person is feeling lesser people around him, right? And that's why this one is usually reported as a condition which is more comfortable and less humid, even though the specific humidity is the same. Let's just complete this understanding by seeing how, because of the increased volume, I can actually hold a little bit more moisture. And this absence of these potential molecules is what creates a sensation of comfort for these two air conditions. Right, so absolute humidity is the same, but the relative humidity is different. Right, okay. One other exercise to further ingrain this idea of psychrometry and using it as a tool of analysis for climate analysis is to understand how dew point is a very important psychrometric process to employ and to question in the design of air conditioning. So, the question here is, plot the psychrometric pathway for cooling air which starts off at 25 degrees and 40% humidity, and I want to cool it down to 8 degrees. Right? That's my goal. Say if I want to provide an air conditioning system or a cooling system which cools air down to 8 degrees. What would the pathway look like? All right. Now, one, you know, response could be, right, if we didn't really know the principles of psychrometrics and we saw, okay, here, this is 10 degrees. I want to get to 8 degrees. This is 8 degrees. I just draw a straight line. Well, in reality, you would not actually be able to do that because in reality, what will happen is as you cool the air, no moisture will leave the system, right? Just cooling of air does not create condensation. Condensation happens at a certain point in its journey, right? It happens, you know, in a step function. It is not a continuous function. So I start cooling the air, right? It keeps going to the left. The humidity ratio remains constant. I, of course, become more and more saturated because the holding capacity of air has gone down till I reach the saturation point or the dew point, right? That is approximately 10 degrees. At 10 degrees, the water will start condensing out of that air and you will start seeing droplets on the cool surface that is cooling the air, right? Which is what happens in an AC. From that point on, the psychrometric pathway will not be, you know, anywhere else, but it'll actually keep tracking the saturation line till I hit 8 degrees. What that means is I actually need to lose this much moisture, right? If I look at these two, I need to lose this much moisture to take air from 25 degrees down to 8 degrees. It can't happen without taking moisture out of the air. And also that the moisture will not leave continuously, which means it won't go down like this. It will only happen when you hit this point. So that's the pathway it'll take. All right. This is an exercise you can use to now actually start using psychrometrics to design cooling systems and at least be able to estimate whether you have overestimated the cooling or underestimated it. Here is a simple problem that we will show later in a worked example, through a worked example on a sheet of paper. Estimate the air conditioning tonnage required for combating the typical fresh air cooling needs in a bedroom, right? So we will do an exercise where, say it's a bedroom in a relatively warm and humid place, say like a Mumbai, where the outside air conditions are 40 degrees dry bulb temperature and RH of 70%, and you wish to create a condition in the room where the temperature is 24 and the humidity is 50%, right? It needs to cool and needs to dehumidify. And for the purposes of other comfort considerations, including air quality, you want 4 air changes per hour, which means that you want all the air to be replenished 4 times every hour, which means every 15 minutes, the entire volume of air needs to be evacuated and replenished, right? So this will give us a sense of the flow rate of air I will need to provide for a room of this size. And here are some conversion factors which will be necessary for that calculation. And we'll go to the next slide and we'll just see the steps that would need to be undertaken, which we will later demonstrate through a worked example. All right, so the first thing you would have to do to know the tonnage of air conditioning needed is to be able to first know what the enthalpy of the two air conditions are, right? We spoke about how enthalpy is the ultimate, you know, indicator of the load or the amount of cooling that I need to do, right? Usually you would have air with high enthalpy, which means more wetness and higher temperature, which needs to be brought down in terms of wetness and in terms of temperature, which means you need to go from high enthalpy to low enthalpy. So the first thing I need to know is how much kilojoules of energy do I need to extract per kg of air, right? So that's my delta enthalpy. The second part of the estimation is to estimate that kg of air, right? How many times per hour do I need to provide that air in the room? Which means how many kgs of air per hour, which will give me eventually a way to calculate the tonnage. Okay, so what I need to do is first estimate the volumetric flow rate using the air changes per hour and the volume of the room, and then multiply the values. So if I end up with kg per hour and I multiply it by kg per kilogram, as we will see when we do the worked example, the two cancel out and I end up with a thing called kilojoules of energy that I need to extract per hour. And all this is, by the way, possible just from the psychrometric chart. All we need to do is start with the enthalpy of the two conditions, right? This is how useful and powerful the chart is. And essentially, tonnage of cooling is nothing but a simple conversion factor. It's a way of conveying kilojoules per hour. So it's a very trivial mathematical step, and we'll show this in a worked example. All right. Another exercise which demonstrates the power of the psychrometric chart as a design tool is to estimate the water you can generate from dehumidification of air in a room. So just like we saw, there is a certain amount of energy that I need to extract. We also alluded to the idea that water will have to be removed from the air to be able to condense it and to be able to cool it. Now, there have been ideas floating around in many instances where people have tried to see if the air from air conditioner, the water from air conditioners can all be combined and really put to some beneficial use, perhaps for gardening or perhaps other water conservation practices. This step-by-step method, again rooted with the intertwined with the psychrometric chart, becomes your tool to analyze that water that you are able to generate. So the first step would be, rather than now estimating enthalpy, because our considerations are not about the energy, we first look at the specific humidity ratios of the ambient and the desired air condition, right? This will give me a sense of the delta of the water per, or the grams of moisture per kg of air that I need to remove. Again, I will have to multiply that value with the volumetric flow rate. So I end up with grams of moisture per kg of air I need to remove. I multiply it by the kg of air per hour, and I end up with basically grams of moisture per kg of hour, right? And that tells me that if I run this AC for X number of hours, this is the amount of moisture I will be able to extract from this room. And if you compound that with other rooms, other air conditioners in a building, we will be able to see whether the amount of moisture that, or the water that you can generate, is it a trivial quantity or is it a very significant amount, right? So this is another very powerful use of the psychrometric chart to do assessments to design thoughtful buildings. to just summarize all the possible pathways that can happen in a psychrometric chart. We saw those two air conditions, one above the other, one to the left and right of each other, so on and so forth. Here are all the possible pathways that can be taken by an air condition, and each one of them actually leads to the creation of a cooling or warming or a heating system, right? So if I start at this point in the center, if I go to the left and to the top, I'm actually doing evaporative cooling. This is the principle of the evaporative cooler, which we will address in a later session. This, which is what happened when we just did dew point cooling, which means the temperature or the air was just cooled at the same humidity level going to the left till it reaches saturation. That is called sensible cooling, because what's happening is only the sensible load, the temperature is reducing, humidity is not reducing, it's not going downwards. Right? There's no latent heat extraction. This process, cooling and dehumidifying, is the process that is the most commonly used method for doing air conditioning. Air conditioning is the only method amongst these three that we just spoke of that can do dehumidification and cooling. Also, again, it does not do it like this, right? Because to first dehumidify, you need to go like this. You need to go to the edge and then go down to a certain point, dump moisture into water, and that will be my final condition, right? So that is how I do cooling and dehumidification. The other processes are heating and humidifying, sensible heating, chemical dehumidifying. So these are all, of course, mirror images of this. This is pure humidifying and this is pure dehumidifying. If you have further questions, please do not hesitate to get in touch with us on our email addresses or through our portal fairconditioning.org. Thank you.